These things just took over me. Just took over my whole body. So I can't even see no more. I'm calling my black woman a bitch. I'm calling my peoples all kinds of things that they not. I'm lost, brother. Can you help me? Can you help me, brother? Please.
You see what we did? We lost the love. I'm talking about the love.
Brother, but brother, but brother, check this out. I still don't understand, man. I'm all high off this shit, man.
Well, what I'm trying to say, my brother, why do we kill each other? Look at our children.
Wake up, family. Before I get started, here's a quick introductory lesson. Most people seem not to understand the difference between race, nationality, and ethnicity. And there's a difference between the three of them, homie. So first, let's get started with race. Race is based on biology and taxonomy. Alright, so race is based on your genetic makeup. You have no choice of what race you are. Understand it. There are three major races, and all people fall into one or more of these groups. The three races are Negroid, Caucasoid, and Mongoloid. Alright? All people predominantly fall into one or more of these categories. Understand it. And it is based off genetics. Alright? Next is ethnicity. Ethnic groups are formed when a group of similar people develop a distinct culture apart from their neighbors who could be the same race of them. Understand it. A person of one race could have a different ethnicity from a person who shares the same race as him. All right. Example, the Omo tribe and the Yoruba tribe are both racially Negro, but they are different ethnic groups. One of them's Omo and one of them's Yoruba. Simple enough, right? All right. So let's go on to nationality. Nationality is based on what land you are from. So American is my nationality. That's what nation I am from. All right. Another example, back to the Omo. The Omo people are an ethnic group. All right. They are racially black and their nationality is Ethiopian. Simple enough. All right. So understand that Puerto Rican is not a race. Don't come at me in the comments talking about that. Mexican is not a race. Cuban is not a race. You know, so on and so forth. Those are all multiracial nations. Am I correct? All of those nations have multiracial beginnings. All right. So dealing with the American Indians, all right, what race were these people? Let me give you an example. What race were the Cherokee? All right. It's funny to me how so many blacks have some sort of connection to the Cherokee, especially right here in South Carolina and North Carolina. But the Cherokee does not accept most of these black people into their nation. And that's because it is what it is, a nation. And it is not a race nor an ethnic group. The Cherokee had many white members such as John Watts who were accepted into this nation. All right. So understand when you say, oh, yeah, well, my descendants were Cherokee. That's a nation that they were from. I get you saying that they were Cherokee. That's cool and all of that. But then I ask you, what race were they and what ethnic group did they originate? All right. Because if you check the census of most of these people, they were documented as being black prior to the 1850s. There's no category for Cherokee on the United States census. All right. There's a category for their race, which is black. And it is on the census. All right. And that's how most of them were documented. All right. Most of today's so-called Native Americans don't even resemble nor live life as the indigenous groups. Most people seem not to understand that fact. When I get black folk on my page telling me that I hate myself and that I hate Africa, that is retarded. I am racially the same as an African. Both of us are part of the Negro race, all right? African would be their nationality. You understand me? I love all my people, and I love all three races. I got no problem with anybody. My problem is with ignorance, all right? So for all of you guys on here saying, well, I'm Hebrew Israelite, I'm Moor, I'm Christian, I'm African American, I got a fact for all of y'all. All of y'all are racially Negroes, all right? And that's what I am identifying as. For the point, I know that the grammar doesn't make sense. I know that we technically ain't black, we brown people. But as far as a racial category, scientifically, that's how I have to identify myself at this point, and which is Negroid. All right? Regardless of nationality, we can't hate each other. All right? And now I know they look to try to divide the Negro race and the sub-races, you know, the Congoid, the Capoid, the Australoid, etc. Don't be fooled, all right? The early African hominid was named Australopithecus afarensis, Austra. Austra is simply a word that means southern, all right? So Australia simply means southern land. What race were the people? They were Negro. Go and do the research for yourself. The Oceanic Negroes, you know, the Negroes of Africa, the Negroes of America, the Negroes of Asia. Do your research. The race of the indigenous American was and is black, and is verified by the census, all right? Just ask any Seminole, Yamasee, right, you from South Carolina, Florida, Georgia, to share their ancestry with you, and you will see that all of their descendants were labeled as black on the census. And I'll get started and share mine, which is descended from the Etowah, which were labeled as being a deep chestnut color, all right? Go type in chestnut and look at how dark a chestnut is, all right? Boom, here we go. One more thing. The revolution will be televised. Peace. Yo, yo, what's up, family? It's your dog, the Ultra Melanite, coming to you live from Charleston, South Carolina, home of the Geechie gullah culture, a.k.a. the Holy City. And today we are going to be using the U.S. genealogical records to show the true identity of the original Americans. We will also be using the U.S. census records to show how we were originally identified at the time and how the modern-day Native Americans stole our identity. I'll be using my own family tree to show and prove these facts to you. My family is the Wassamasaw tribe of the Etowah, Edisto, Yamasee, Varnatown Indians. Thus, my last name is Varna. So let's go ahead and jump right to it so I won't leave y'all waiting too long. Here we go. First, I'll start by explaining the tribes in the Tri-County area of South Carolina in relation to me. If you're from North Charleston, you probably remember Shakora Elementary School or Shakora Avenue, but what you probably didn't know is that these places were named after the Shakora Indian, which were said to be an indigenous group that inhabited South Carolina a long, long time ago. They were probably ancestors of a group of people that were named the Waccamaw, who were encountered by the Europeans when they arrived in 1521. A group of Waccamaw men were captured by the Spanish, and they were shipped to the Bahamas for re-education, or so they say, where they were supposed to learn Spanish in the way of the European, shipped back to South Carolina for assimilation into the government. Most of these men died. However, a couple of them survived, and one of those men ended up being named Francisco de Socorro in reference to the Socorro Indians that used to live here a long time ago. All right? There were also other groups of Indians that inhabited the area, such as the Edisto, the Etowah, the Yuchi, the Catawba, the Gwale, you know, the Kasubo and Muscogee groups, you know, just to name a few of them. Understand that the dynamics of South Carolina changed after the Yamasee War, which absorbed most of these groups into a confederation against the European. So realize that the Yamasee was not an original ethnic group, all right? They were a nation of different ethnic groups of the southeastern United States that joined forces against the European. Towards the end of the war, some so-called indigenous groups defected and joined side with the colonists. One of those groups was the Cherokee Indians, which it was said that they even captured and killed and enslaved their own indigenous brothers and sisters. But I will say, understand that the Cherokee is not just a multi-ethnical group. They are a multi-racial group, which means that they have all three races comprised inside that group of people. You know, so you had Europeans inside the mix, you had Africans inside the mix, and you had indigenous Americans inside the mix. The Mongoloid got introduced into the Cherokee a little bit later on. For the most part, they were products of the quartering system, which y'all should all know about, where, you know, they had just a mix, a very mixed multiracial culture. All right. From one of these groups came my grandma, who was named Rose Walker Varner. She was an Etowah slave and a wife to the German plantation organizer William Lee Varner. All right. Although she is Etowah, she is labeled as black on the census, which is her race. And that's where a lot of confusion comes at with the paper genocide. They confuse y'all with ethnicity and race on something like the census. You know, ethnically, she was Etowah. Racially, she is black. All right, that's a good example of what we call the confusion of the paper genocide. All right, now my grandmama, who was labeled as a slave, she was also obviously given as a wife to this German plantation organizer, which I can tell by the fact that she had a picture taken. You know, only wealthy people had pictures taken in the early 1800s. Also, by the clothing that she's wearing on the pictures, you can tell that she's not a low-class farm girl or any low-class citizen. She looked like she was very well dressed and very well taken care of at the time, you know. So that goes to speak on the level of slavery that you know, we gotta address to people. You know, she was not part of that incarcerated form of slavery. She was limited by the government because of her race, her ethnicity, and her race. All right. Now, her oldest son was a guy named William Lee Varner Jr., which also goes to say that this had to be more than just a slave owner, you know, raping his slave, because the firstborn child was actually named after him. Now, what slave master do you know of would name their firstborn child, give their firstborn bastard slave child their namesake? I don't think that happened too often. And also, I couldn't find any other white family members descended from this guy. So it looks like these were his only children from the research that I've done on him. Anyway, I could be wrong. I am descended from Rose Walker Varner's youngest son, who was James Marion Varner, and he was documented as being mulatto sometimes on the census, which is a mixture between a white and a black, and he was documented as being black sometimes on the census, all right? Her descendants, Rose Walker Varner's descendants, still survive that area today as the Etowah and the Varner Town tribes of Wassamasaw Indians, all right? We are the remnant of the Etowah, which inhabited the area a long time ago. All right. The Etowah side of the family remains predominantly black. On the other hand, the Varner Town has become virtually non-black. Although they are recognized as an indigenous group, they have been overrun by a European and a Asian genome. All right. They should be black, and I can prove it with, you know, some simple documents. All right. The progenitors of the Varner Town side of the Wassamasaw Indians are Rose Walker Varner's oldest son, which was William Lee Varner Jr., who was labeled as mulatto on the census, and his wife, Mamie Williams, who was labeled as black on the census, all right, which is now updated to say Native American on Mamie Williams. Reason being is one of her family members fought to be identified as an indigenous person, being the fact that they had the records proving that they were always here. They didn't get off of a slave ship. So at the point in time that Mamie Williams was living, she was documented as black on the census, and has a copy of the census right here stating that. All right. That's another example of the paper genocide. So my question is that if both progenitors of this nation are racially black, then why are most members of their group non-black? Why do they discredit the blacks, the racially black people who should be members, all right, who definitely have this bloodline? See, a lot of their descendants married into white families, giving the non-black descendants the capability to claim allegiance to this indigenous nation, all right, and cause them to separate themselves from the blacks, because obviously blacks were treated very bad at the time. So they didn't want to be identified with the blacks. They wanted to be identified with the whites and the other non-blacks, so they can get some better treatment. All right. Now, all of the pictures online that you see of the Varner Town tribe of Wassamasaw Indians depict non-black people, some of them even being pure white, which I can say some of them can claim ancestry. Some of them do have the bloodline, being the fact that we know that they intermix with white families like the Clarks and the Dangerfields later on, all right? But how could there be no blacks when Mary and William were racially black? They should at least have some racially black members of that tribe, being that both progenitors of that nation were black. All right, that's not just paper genocide. That's a little bit of identity theft in there also, you know. You know, that's just crazy, all right? But that's a quick view of my family's branches, of two of the branches of my family, the Etowah tribe of Wassamasaw Indians and the Varnatown tribe of Wassamasaw Indians. All right, with all that being said, let me make it clear that I don't align myself with any nation, all right? I don't align myself with Cherokee, Yamasee. You never hear me say anything about a nation, all right? Don't get confused. I align myself with the indigenous people of the world, as we are the people of, we are the victims of genocide, and that's where my love extends to at this point in time. All right, now that you got the bloodline, let's deal with the culture. My culture right here in Charleston, South Carolina, is called the Geechie gullah culture. Now, I know a lot of us Geechies were taught as children that we are the descendants of African slaves, and that a remnant of that culture survives today, and that's where the Geechie gullah culture originates. Well, I'm here to tell you that that's a lie, so let's deal with a fact. I'll prove to you that the Geechie gullah culture is indigenous American in nature, all right? So let's start with the facts first. As y'all know, I like to deal with grammar, so let's deal with the grammar behind the word Geechie gullah, all right? Geechie gullah originates on the southeastern coast and is a compound word. The first term, Geechie, applies to a group of people that were living on the Ogeechee River in Georgia. As a result of the Yamasee War in 1715, the Geechies were pushed to the coast of Carolina, Georgia, and Florida. All right, so get that. The first word is based off an indigenous American group. Is there anybody that can dispute that? I think not. All right, let's move forward to the second word, which is Gwale. Gwale represents a tribe that lived in the South Carolina coastline during the arrival of the European Latin in the 1500s. So here we go again. The second word of this compound word is used to identify a group of indigenous people that were living in South Carolina during the time of the European arrival. All right, so both of these words, Geechie and gullah, both originate or were used to identify groups of people that were in the Americas during the time of the European. All right, the culture of the Ogeechee and the Gwale combined to create the Geechie gullah culture, which composes of many different ethnic groups who were opposed to assimilation. Get that. The Geechie gullah culture composes of many different ethnic groups who were opposed to assimilation, all right? I think it would be safe to say that racially, these people were black. Regardless of what people tell you, let's do the math for yourself, all right? Let's start with ethnicity and race. The Ogeechee River is in the southeastern United States. Today, the Geechies are all black, true or false? I live in Charleston, South Carolina. I'm a Geechie gullah myself, and I've never seen an Asian or a non-black Geechie, all right? So, if we were named by a local river and we today are all black, I think it would be safe to say that the people on the river at that time that created this culture were all black. 1 + 1 = 2. It's not like these people were Mongol and later turned black. That would be retarded to say, all right? Although I know it could happen. I don't want to hear all of the crazy comments about that, all right? So the original race at the time of the European arrival was black. Is there anybody that can dispute that? All right, dig it. Next, let's go to gullah food. I'll start with grits, which is a staple of Southern cooking and also South Carolina state food. Grits is labeled as a Native American food, but have you ever seen an Asian, Mongol, Native American eating shrimp and grits? Shrimp and grits is one of the gullah's native or unique dishes. All right? When I was young, non-blacks did not eat this food at all. Shrimp and grits, fish and grits, that's something that's definitely unique to black people here. All right? So how is it that soul food that blacks eat to this day is attributed to be coming from the Mongol or Asian Native Americans, all right? I grew up on foods like fish and grits and shrimp and grits. And I'll tell you what, milling grits was an art form that would have had to be learned because Africa did not have corn. I understand that all places have a form of porridge. I understand that the Africans ate a form of porridge, but their porridge was not corn-based because they didn't have corn. All right, we know that soul food is attributed to Black people to this day. The Asian people don't eat neck bones and lima beans. And I know a lot of you people watching this right now may have never eaten these foods. That's all cool. Come to Charleston and we'll give you all a taste of a real good food experience. All right. There are many other foods that are unique to Charleston in the southeastern United States. Foods that do not originate in Africa where corn doesn't grow. Most Mongol or Asian Native Americans eat a Euro-American diet, utilizing corn in many ways, but not unique as the gullah culture. All right? Now, this historian says, and I quote, that soul food is actually Native American food. The art of smoking meats, boiling soups, eating things like sweet potato pie. Come on, man. How much of y'all know an Asian Native American that makes sweet potato pie? Or using smoked neck bones and things of the sort. That's a thing that's unique to us here. Don't give that to anybody else. All right? You know, I got Black people telling me that this food culture originates in Africa, and I got white people saying that this food culture originates with the Native Americans. All right, I hear to say that both of y'all are wrong. The food culture originates with the indigenous Black America, and it remains with us to this day. All right, come on, man. Simple. 1 + 1 gotta equal 2. Is there anyone who can dispute that? All right. For all of the Asian Native Americans, the ones with the Siberian genome, for all of y'all, do y'all eat soul food? When we speak of soul food, I know y'all say that disgusts y'all. That's some low-class citizen food, right? But yet this historian says it originates with y'all, you dig? And for all of you so-called African wannabes, y'all say that this culture originated in Africa, huh? Show me somebody in Africa who's got corn and making grits out of that bad boy, you know, eating shrimp and grits, you dig? All right, come on, both of y'all wrong. Yeah, you know, you can't steal our heritage right here. All right, lastly, real quick, let's talk the gullah language. And while we're at it, we're going to identify another nation of indigenous people called the Seminole. All right, let's talk the dialect. The dialect is considered English Creole, and our branch is considered a Bahamian dialect, even though the dialect originated on the mainland and spread to the islands as documented by these people. And here's a document showing and proving this. I can't say for sure how true this is, but here's document proving this. Evidence also exists in the fact that white people on the island speak Creole, proving that they were infused in the indigenous culture, you know. Why would the European nobility speak a much slave language? You understand me? All right. Gullah language itself, or the Gullah dialect itself, is considered Afro-Seminole. Am I right? The Gullah language is considered Afro-Seminole. So with that being said, these people who identify in our culture automatically identify our culture as being part with one of these indigenous culture. But somehow some of you people don't, you know. The Seminole was a Black, racially Black, southeastern indigenous confederation and obviously became a meaningful part of the gullah culture and the Creole island culture. The reason why the Seminole was so important in the Geechie and the island culture is because they were strong enough to house the indigenous Black refugees. So this is a factual brief history, you know, on the Seminole. All right, and here we go with the terminology. All right. The Seminole was so instrumental in our Afro-Seminole culture that we're going to move right into the fake Native Americans so I can piss off some more people by speaking the truth. The Seminole is a nation, not an ethnic group, not a racial group. Racially, they were Black people as represented by the gullah people and culture. The people didn't call themselves Seminoles. It was a name given to them by the Spanish. The word Seminole itself has the grammar behind the word Seminole. It means runaway or refugee. All right? It is the same as the word maroon, which were the runaways on the islands in the southeastern United States. The exact same word, two different languages. You understand me? Now, why would anyone call themselves a runaway? Run away from what? Run away from who? And run away when? Once again, I'll tell you. The defeat and the defection of indigenous clans after the Yamasee War caused the tribes who didn't assimilate to become refugees or runaway. You dig? It's that simple. The clans who did not wish to assimilate ended up becoming refugees or runaways. All right? The runaway tribes consolidated again in Florida because Florida was still Spanish-owned at this time. So the British couldn't just come down there and rally these people together. By the mid-1700s, the Seminole was a people consolidated of many tribes and gained strength. And since they were called the Seminole, the Cimarron, the wild runaway, that term kind of stuck with them as the newly formed tribe. And they were ready for war. Also by the mid-1700s, the Spanish surrendered Florida to the English, forcing the Seminoles back into war, where they reportedly freed several hundred prisoners of war. Alright? This persisted until the 1830s, the Indian Removal Act, which pushed all Native Americans west of the Mississippi. That's how you get black people west of the Mississippi, because of the Indian Removal Act. How else did you get that far west? Simple, common sense. Alright, the Seminole was one of the groups that did not comply, leaving several communities of indigenous black Americans in the southeast. The Seminoles fought wars, ultimately losing to the colonists and their Native American help, such as the Cherokee. Alright, now for a synopsis. Alright, no matter what y'all think, being a race does not constitute your nationality. Being black does not constitute you being African. That's why I started this grammar lesson off explaining the difference between nationality, race, and ethnicity. I never said I had a problem with any Africans. Racially, we are the same. Phenotypically, we are very similar. I explained that in the very first video. But obviously, if you're still asking that question, you don't have a high enough IQ to understand what I'm saying. All right, so you need to go back to school. Alright? Point 2. My family has been in this area from at least the late 1700s to the early 1800s, as I can prove, existing as a remnant of one of the tribes of the Yamasee War, known as the Etowah. You dig? My family survived here for at least the past couple hundred years as the Etowah ethnic group. Racially, we were identified as black people, colored people, and Negro, so on and so forth. All right. Point 3. The Geechie gullah culture originated in the southeastern United States, with the main bloodlines being people related to the Uchi, the Seminole, and the Yamasee tribes, these other ethnic groups that formed into one confederation. Racially, these people were black. Go find anybody from any one of these tribes, and if they were documented on the census, they were documented as being black. If they were not documented as being black or colored, then they were not of those Indian or indigenous nations. All right, our culture is considered by most historians to be Afro-Seminole. There's not much African elements to my culture. All right, and if there is, how about you prove it to me? All right. Anyone that's saying my people are from Africa needs to show and prove with facts, all right? Not just some old BS rhetoric, not just coming on here and say, oh, this guy's crazy, all right? Prove it with facts. I can always admit when I'm wrong, but the fact of the matter is I'm presenting facts to you guys. All my research prove what I say to be true and prove what you say to be fruitless, all right? Everything attributed to my culture can be found to originate here. Do a fact check. You understand me?